the morning star, drive on 17.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the morning star, drive, you know.
Hey guys, how's it going? It is Thursday, April 15th, and this is the Morning Star Drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and make sure to support us on Patreon. So today, it is Thursday, so we'll get some coronavirus updates, question and answer, and of course, we have Victory Rhymes by Yungse from South Africa. All right, guys, how's it going? How are you guys doing today? Right, it is, we're getting to the last half of the week, and I hope you guys have enjoyed everything so far. For me, a lot of things on my mind right now, because, you know, today is the 14th, okay? Oh, it's 15th today, right? It's the 15th. So, we just had Wednesday service, but yet, just yesterday, I got an email from the Canadian Embassy, and they're like, the Malaysian government is asking all foreigners with, you know, with the expired social visit passes, which is me, to leave by the 21st, which is like next Tuesday. So I am in a little bit of a rut here. I'm wondering what's the next best thing for me to do, but we'll see what's going to happen. Not really sure yet. I am going to plan into getting an extension, but not sure if it's actually going to happen. But of course, especially during this week, when it's the week of doing things according to the Holy Spirit's program, I do have to think about, what do I need to do? Right, so maybe the Holy Spirit's changing the program and I have to open my heart to see what is actually happening, even though I don't want to go and that's a secret. Either way, okay, so what's happening today, guys? Everyone, just very grateful and thankful. Even if I go over to Canada, it doesn't mean that I'm going to stop these podcasts, and it doesn't mean that I'm going to like change the time of these podcasts either. I'm going to keep the podcast to the same time as much as I can, right? And the thing that's kind of cool and interesting is it will actually give me more time to do it. So like, for instance, it's 15 hours behind, which means that if it's like 6 a.m. is when I put out the podcast, here's the cool thing. If it's 6 a.m., the podcast comes out, which means that's 3 p.m. in Vancouver, if I go back, right? So if it's 3 p.m., I almost have the entire day to do it. It's kind of cool. It's kind of interesting. Like, I can do it like on, you know, every single day in the morning to post it up and get it ready for. And it'll be actually even more up to date than it is here. Either way, so that is something that I am thinking about, seeing what's the next best thing to do. But I do need to pray about this and see what the Holy Spirit really wants, right? So just reminding everyone else to, you know, put in a comment, a like, and pray for me that I will follow exactly what the Holy Spirit wants and I will not resist. Like the Holy Spirit says, like, nope, you got to go. I'm like, no, I don't want to go, right? So, you know, I got to follow what the Holy Spirit wants more than anything else. All right, so just, you know, leave a little like and comment there just to encourage me, because I will need a little bit of encouragement if I really have to leave this place. All right. Oh, and we had the Lab 78 on Tuesday night. Hope you guys really enjoyed that. It's just kind of a fun time, me talking to everyone about my experiences here in Malaysia. There is a little bit of toilet humor in there, but I hope you guys really enjoyed that one too. Tons of people are just like, you know, they're really writing a lot of stuff saying that it was really funny. So I hope that you guys will enjoy this too. Also, on Sunday, this Sunday, who are we going to meet? Right? So we just listened. This week we met who? We met Yuna Lee from Houston, Texas. And we're going to stay in Houston, Texas for next week's Sunday edition. We're going to meet someone we've already met, but in a different setting. So we're going to meet someone from the Sumney Boys separately from each other, right? So today we're going to meet, this week, next Sunday edition, we're going to meet Michael Henry Jr., one of the Sumney Boys. We're going to kind of get his personal story of how he came. Someone who's came to Providence at a very, very early age. Really thankful with all his time that he put into this interview. So go ahead, catch that interview. And he's going to talk about like different stories about some of the songs that he's written too. So that is what's going on. Hope you guys are praying for me already in your hearts so that I will follow the direction of the Holy Spirit. Please, God, let me stay. But either way, right? So let's get into today's featured artist of the day. So who is a featured artist? Today's featured artist is going to be, because we just talked about Michael Henry Jr. from the Sumney Boys, we're going to start with the Sumney Boys song. The song is called Pink Sunset, right? And this is one of the songs that if you go way back to their interview, way back when, this is a song that they requested. So this is Pink Sunset from the Sumney Boys from America. Second song is Francis Han from New York with Morning Star from his jazz band. And also, last but not least, post-rock artist we all love, Xeniac from the Paper Music Associates in Korea. And that song is going to be called Star Launcher. So more than anything else, guys, let's make sure that we keep all of our favorite member artists in our prayers and make sure that we give them that extra boost of spiritual energy that will help them to go even further in the world. That song was Star Launcher from Zeniac from the Paper Music Associates in Korea. Before that, Francis Han with his jazz band from New York, and that song was Morning Star. And last but not least, it's a featured artist of the day. That first song was from the Sumney Boys in America, and that song was Pink Sunset. So let's get into some news going on for the day. Let's see what's going on, especially first with the coronavirus updates. In the world, 137.7 million cases, 2.9 million deaths. Now, here's the good part, guys. Once again, faster than before, mortality rate has gone down in the global scale. This is huge, right? 2.15%. It went down 0.01%. Top six countries going by daily infection rates. We have the US, 32 million cases, 576,000 deaths at 1.8%. India, 13.8 million cases, 171,000 deaths at 1.24%. Brazil, 13.5 million cases, 355,000 deaths at 2.63%. Turkey, 3.9 million cases, 34,000 deaths at 0.87%. Argentina, 2.5 million cases, 57,000 deaths at 2.27%. And Iran, once again, comes back into the mix with 2.1 million cases, 65,000 deaths at a 3.07% clip. Very interesting that when you look at India and Brazil, you're looking just 2 weeks ago when Brazil was 300,000-400,000 cases above India, and within these 2 weeks now, India is 300,000 cases above Brazil, which means there's a big 600,000-700,000 case swing in the last 2 weeks. So that's quite interesting to see. Sweden, 1.56%, and they went down in their mortality rate. Great news. Actually, they went down 0.03%. So that's a very, very huge jump from 1.59 to 1.56. And then Belgium, once being the highest mortality rate, is down to 2.53%. Now let's take a look at daily infection rates and see what's going on. India, 160,000 cases a day. Now, one thing we do have to take into consideration is India has a population of 1.3 billion people. So we got to kind of take that into context, what it means to have 160,000 cases a day. It's the same thing with the U.S. In the U.S., 340 million people in the world with 56,000 cases in a day, which is very different from Turkey with 83 million people, but 54,000, right? So the more and more you look at that, there's a huge discrepancy. Like, you might look at just the numbers and say, oh my gosh, India's going crazy. And the answer is actually they were just doing really, really well before. That's kind of the answer. They were doing really, really well for a country with 1.3 billion people. Or you could even say that the testing has gotten better more than anything else, right? The U.S., very interestingly, the U.S., they have basically gone, what would you call it? The U.S. has basically gone like, the U.S. has dropped so significantly, but they have crazy testing and crazy vaccinations. So that is a good sign there. Then we have Brazil, right? Brazil is 38,000 cases in a day. Iran, 23,000, and then Argentina with 19,000 cases in a single day. Over here, Southeast Asia, Philippines still on top with 11,000 cases in a day. Indonesia with 4,800, and then Malaysia, their numbers drop down to 1,300. And partly, deeply in my heart, I'm hoping that they extend the MCO. Please, I'm hoping they do, but we'll see what happens. Either way, let's go into some current news, right? Top three news. We're going to talk about some COVID, the vaccine news, and some other things that are happening around the world. We'll start off with vaccine news. So Johnson & Johnson. Now, everyone knows about this. This is kind of one of the later vaccines that came out, and the thing that made this one special is it is a single dose. You just get it once and it's done, right? So here it is. Johnson & Johnson vaccines have been paused, right? They're stopping it right now, because there's rare blood clots. Now, what does this mean? So the U.S., South Africa, and the European Union will temporarily stop the rollout of the Johnson & Johnson COVID jab. Now, because there's reports of rare blood clotting. So there are six cases that were detected in more than 6.8 million doses of the vaccine. And this is what the U.S. FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, said. And Johnson & Johnson has paused its EU rollout, which started this week. And it follows similar cases after doses of the AstraZeneca vaccine, which prompted curbs to its use also. And the FDA was basically saying it was recommending the temporary pause out of an abundance of caution. And it confirmed that one patient died from blood clotting complications and another is in critical condition. So all six cases were in women aged between 18 and 48 with symptoms appearing 6 to 13 days after vaccination. And following the advice, all federal sites in the U.S. have stopped using the vaccine until further investigations into its safety are completed. And state and private contractors are expected to follow suit. And the U.S. has by far the most confirmed cases of the coronavirus. We know there's 31 million plus over like 560,000 deaths, which is, you know, these are both world highs. But Johnson & Johnson is a U.S. healthcare company where the vaccine was developed mainly by its pharmaceutical branch in Belgium and is also known as Janssen. So unlike some of the other jabs, like we said before, it's a single shot stored at normal refrigerator temperatures, which is great. So it's very easy to distribute in hotter climates or more remote areas. And while many countries have pre-ordered millions of doses, it has only been approved in a few nations. And it was cleared for use in the U.S. on February 27th, but the Pfizer, BioNTech, and Moderna vaccines have been used more widely. And the Johnson & Johnson vaccine has been administered to nearly 7 million people in the U.S., which is around 3% of the total immunizations given so far. Now, Dr. Anthony Fauci, the country's top COVID advisor, said it was too early to comment on whether it could have its authorization revoked. And South Africa, which was the first country to administer the vaccine, has also paused its use, although no cases of blood clots have been reported in the country. And the jab became the preferred vaccine after studies showed it had a higher protection rate against the South African variant than other jabs. And since mid-February, nearly 300,000 healthcare workers have received it in South Africa. The WHO had told Reuters it was monitoring the situation and waiting for reports from the U.S. and European regulators. But the deliveries of the vaccine to the EU countries started just 24 hours before Johnson & Johnson said it would pause the European rollout, as it has not been administered in the EU yet. So experts there are still looking to the United States to see what their next move is, right? So in the EU, the vaccine rollout has been criticized widely, and especially by the WHO, for being too slow, and there are concerns this latest delay could throw it into further turmoil. Now, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine is yet to be approved in the UK, although 30 million doses are on pre-order. The Department of Health said the rollout delay would not affect vaccine supplies in the UK or derail the aim to offer a jab to all adults by the end of July. Now, Canada has pre-ordered 10 million doses of the vaccine and is still on track to receive the first shipment by the end of the month, and this is what Prime Minister Justin Trudeau said. So, of course, everyone is following very closely with the developments in the U.S., and, you know, what do we know so far about the latest cases of the blood clots? Well, in a joint statement, the FDA and the CDC said they were reviewing data involving 6 reported U.S. cases of a very rare and severe type of blood clot in individuals after receiving this Johnson & Johnson jab. And it said the clotting was called cerebral venous sinus thrombosis, or CVST. And the statement said that this type of blood clot needed a different treatment than usual. So the common treatment for this is kind of an anticoagulant drug called heparin, and it could be dangerous, they said. So pending a further review, the FDA and CDC recommended a pause in the use of the vaccine out of an abundance of caution. The joint statement said that people who have received the Johnson & Johnson vaccine who develop severe headache, abdominal pain, leg pain, or shortness of breath within 3 weeks after vaccination should contact their health providers. Now, Johnson & Johnson, they had a statement, and they issued a statement saying that it shared all adverse event reports with the health authorities, and they also added that they're aware of this thromboembolic events, including those with thrombocytopenia, that have been reported with these coronavirus vaccines. So at present, no clear causal relationship has been established between these rare events and the Johnson & Johnson COVID-19 vaccine. So, you know, it's a cautious approach. But it's incredibly rare what is happening over there too. So let's just see what happens over there with this Johnson & Johnson vaccine, okay? Now, let's go into another coronavirus good news. Well, it's something very interesting, is Israel may be reaching herd immunity. So a leading Israeli doctor believes the country may be close to reaching herd immunity, and this happens when enough of the population has protection against an infection that it stops being able to spread. And even people who don't themselves have immunity are indirectly protected, right? So for the coronavirus, the estimated threshold for herd immunity is about 65 to 70% of the people need to get it. But of course, in the UK, well, some of the countries are more cautious, right? And they said, of course, you need more extreme caution, and you shouldn't just conclude that herd immunity has been reached, right? And it's very, very interesting, but it's still too early to tell. And Israel is not saying that they have it, but they say they're close to it, right? And they want to see what's happening in Israel. Do the cases continue to fall and they stay at low levels? So reaching this level of population immunity is important to protect people who can't be vaccinated or whose immune system is too weak to produce a good protective response. And in Israel, more than half, right, 5.3 million of its residents have been vaccinated, and an additional 830,000 people have tested positive for the virus in the past, which should give them some natural immunity, right? So the people who have already tested positive, is if it's 830,000, you add that to the 5.3, which is more than half. That means you're looking at like 6.1, right? 6.1, 6.2 million, which is close to 65% of all of Israel has gotten the jab or they're immune. And it becomes a little bit more natural. So that works out as roughly 68% of the population who are likely to have antibodies in their blood, which can fight off the virus. And there's like some professors One is a director at Israel's largest hospital at the Sheba Medical Center, said herd immunity was the only explanation for the fact that cases continued to fall even as more restrictions were lifted, and there is continuous decline despite returning to near normalcy. Right, so that's a good sign for Israel. The continuous decline despite returning to near normalcy, right? And this tells us that even if a person is infected, most people they meet walking around won't be affected by them. And cases are falling in all age groups, including children, and even though under 16s are not generally being vaccinated. So you guys got to understand how herd immunity works, right? So experts think that with no restrictions in place, someone infected with the original strain of the virus that causes a coronavirus will infect, on average, 3 to 4 other people. So the R naught is 3 or 4, okay? So if it's 3, then in theory, once 2/3 of the population becomes immune to the virus, an infected person will, on average, only pass it to one other person. And that's enough for the virus to spread, but not enough for it to grow. So basically, you've eliminated 2 of those 3 people from the chain of transmission. It sounds simple on paper, but in reality, though, it's a little bit more complicated because the vaccines are not 100%, right? The efficacies right now is like some of them is 90%, 85%, whatever. Some is 95%. And even when they stop people from getting sick, they don't completely block infections in everyone. So that means some vaccinated people might still be able to pass on the virus. And not everyone with the past COVID infection has strong or long-lasting natural immunity. And newer variants of the virus are more transmissible. This means we have to inoculate many more people before we reach that magic threshold. But it's not all bad news. And they would say that they should not be looking for herd immunity alone as a sign that you can lift all public health measures and get back to normal. And this is what Dr. Pitt explained. Rather, you should be looking for consistently low levels of the coronavirus infection. So if they actually reach herd immunity, then what's the next step? So far, new variants don't seem to be resistant to the vaccine. But a future variant, which does show resistance to the virus, right, as one of the professors was explaining, could mean people have less protection and the country could dip below the herd immunity threshold. And, this isn't insurmountable, but it could be tackled with tweaks to the vaccine, as already happens with the annual flu jab. So it serves as an important reminder, though, that even if Israel has reached herd immunity and if the UK follows, this is not necessarily a permanent state. So we can look at what's happened with measles in recent years. Right, the virus was considered to have been eliminated in the UK, but the WHO revoked this status in 2019 after a marked increase in measles cases driven by a fall in the proportion of vaccinated people. Right, so measles, though, is highly contagious, and each infected person infects roughly 15 other people, so vaccination coverage needs to be over 90% to prevent outbreaks. So that's quite interesting to see that too. But that's what's happening over there. Like, herd immunity, it's a good test study to see how Israel is doing it. Once Israel hits that, it's going to be very, very interesting for us to see how this is going to work in other countries too. Last but not least, we're going to go back to Russia and America. Or not Russia. So Russia and the Ukraine, I talked about this yesterday. So NATO now. NATO warns Russia over forces near Ukraine. So NATO decried the largest massing of Russian troops to Ukraine's eastern border, while the Kremlin slams Washington's support for Kiev. So tensions between Russia and the West rose on Tuesday over fears Moscow is attempting to escalate its conflict with Ukraine over the Donbas region. So addressing reporters alongside Ukraine's foreign ministry at NATO's headquarters in Brussels, the alliance's secretary general accused Russia of having moved thousands of combat-ready troops to the Ukraine borders. Now, people were urging Russia, like the NATO was urging Russia, that it was unjustified, and this largest massing of Russian troops since Russia annexed Ukraine's southern Crimean peninsula in March of 2014 after an uprising that toppled former Kremlin-friendly President Viktor Yanukovych, and then called on Moscow to reverse course. So, they're basically NATO saying Russia has to end this military buildup in and around the Ukraine and stop its provocations and de-escalate immediately, right? And they said that this troop deployment is deeply concerning. But meanwhile, Moscow on Tuesday accused NATO and leading members of the United States of turning Ukraine into a powder keg. with increasing arms supplies, so Russian agencies reported, citing the foreign ministry. So Deputy Foreign Minister Ryabkov was quoted as saying that military support provided by Washington to Kiev posed a serious challenge to Russia and warned that Moscow would do everything possible to ensure its security in the event of an escalation in the Donbas conflict. Now, Ryabkov also urged Washington to ensure two U.S. warships due to arrive in the Black Sea this week stay well away from Crimea for their own good, saying the risk of unspecified incidents was very high. And, you know, basically they said there's no reason for American ships to be doing, you know, to be near the shores. So they're saying that this is purely a provocative action. And provocative in the direct sense of the word, they are testing the strength and playing on their nerves, and they will not succeed. So it seems that things are getting pretty crazy, right? NATO's plea came a day after Kiev accused the Kremlin of ignoring its request for talks between the two countries' presidents over the military buildup. So this is something we got to kind of keep our eyes on, and we'll see what's actually going to happen between the U.S. and the U.S. and the West, or NATO. Some good news is the U.S. President Joe Biden had a phone call with the President of Russia, Vladimir Putin, and they emphasized Washington's unwavering commitment to Ukraine's sovereignty and expressed concern over the Russian military buildup. And the President also voiced concerns over the sudden Russian military buildup in occupied Crimea and on Ukraine's borders, and called on Russia to de-escalate tensions, right? So let's see what happens. They are having a meeting over the phone. We'll see what the what will come from that result. Okay, so that's the three big news for today. Hope you guys can kind of get an idea of what is happening around the world. What is God doing? Okay, so now that we have the world news all done with, we're going to get into something a little bit more spiritual. Let's have a time of praise and worship. We're going to start with Let's Make God and the Holy Spirit Rejoice, and then the Person of Mission Running for Providence, and then we'll finish with One Love. So I hope that everyone here, as one body of the Morningstar Drive, let's spend this time together giving glory and praise and honor to the Holy Trinity.
Hey! a new history. Go out and run today, and tomorrow you will fly. Preaching and preaching again, with a heart of purpose. How many years passed since the day you left your hometown? Turn away from the world, time to run, time to fly. If you give all of your youth, it won't be in vain. Turn away from the world, rapture now, live with love. Give your youth, it won't be in vain. You who run only for God on the of life. Preach to Korea today, then go preach to all the world. Providence life is the best, it is always worthwhile. How many years passed since you left from the former faith? Now turn toward the world, time to run, time to fly. If you give all of your youth, it won't be in vain. Now turn toward the world, rapture now, live with love. Give your youth, it won't be in vain. You who row only for God on the rock of life, you sail the Arctic Sea. Now today sail all the world. Strong winds and waves always come on the vast wide oceans. How many years passed since you came to the new history? Turn away from the storms, time to run, time to fly. History, heaven here on earth. Turn away from the storms, rapture now, live with love. Give your youth, it won't be in
Lord, and love this history, using all the strength I have in me, I will give my life to you. I will live only for you. I love you so with my heart and will. stand again. Should my bones return to dust? Should my mind be lost and fade away? No, my love will never change. It will go to you
One Love. And before that, the Person of Mission Running for Providence and Let's Make God and the Holy Spirit Rejoice. So what does this all mean, guys? We're going to go into a little bit of word study. But today's word study, because it's Thursday, is always going to be question and answer. And I have a very, very interesting question, right? A question I just got yesterday, and it's about the story of Balaam and his donkey. Okay, now this is not about the donkey part, right? Because this is right before the donkey. Is when you look at Numbers chapter 22, this is a story where, you know, basically God told him, do not go and bless him, don't do anything that they say. And then Balak, which was the prince at that time, kept coming and saying, please, you got to curse these people, you got to curse these people. And finally he gives and says, all right, just stay the night. And I will, you know, let's figure this out. You know, I'm going to figure this out for you guys. So let's see what we can do. So what happens here is he gets some revelation at night, and God tells him to go with him. Okay. And then two verses later, like that's verse 20, when God says, all right, whenever the princes call you, go with them. Okay. And then the next day, next morning, from verse 22, then God rebukes him for going with him. And then it's like, wait, that doesn't make any sense. How could you go with him when you said to go with him, right? So we have a couple of things that we're looking at. And the question is, why would God rebuke Balaam if he was the one that told him to go, but then you get angry when he goes, okay? So there are going to be a couple of different reasonings that we can look at in this instance, okay? So I'm going to look at two different ones, and I don't actually have the answer that Sunseem gave, right? But I will give you two answers that I can deduce. And I can't really tell you the full answer, like, this is actually what happened. Okay, so we do know this story that Balaam was the one that whoever he blesses gets blessed by God, and whoever he curses gets cursed. And he kept cursing and blessing the Israelites and cursing his enemies, right? And the king, of course, Balak at that time was so upset at him. But this final time, he's like, please come, I'll give you all the riches, whatever it is. And he's finally like, oh my gosh, God told me not to follow these people, but he kind of caved in. Because if he really did what God wanted, what would he do? He would literally say, nope, I can't do anything you say. I only follow God. And if he really, really only followed God, then he would really just say, bug off, okay? I don't want to talk to you guys. But he actually told him this day and night, and he went to talk to God again. Now, when you look at the NIV version, it's a little bit different than the actual, like, it's not as detailed, right? When you look at the New International Version in verse 20, God comes to Balaam at night and says, since these men have come to summon you, go with them, but do only what I tell you, right? So basically saying these people come to summon you, so they'll come to you, call you, and you got to go when they call you, right? However, it's a little bit more detailed than the King James Version, which is a little bit more word for word. And we talked about this before, the different types of versions of interpretations of the Bible. But if you look at the King James, which is more literal, more word for word, it says, God came unto Balaam at night and said unto him, if the men come to call thee, rise up and go with them. But yet the word which I shall say unto thee, that shalt thou do. Okay, so there's something that's very, very specific here that we can look into and say this could possibly be a reason. It says that if the men come to call thee, then rise up and go with them. Okay, and then of course in verse 22, God's anger was kindled because he went. Okay, that he, you know, God was, his anger arose because he went. Because in verse 21, Balaam rose up in the morning, saddled his ass, that's what it says in King James Version, right? Saddled his donkey and went with the princes of Moab, okay? So one of the different reasons that that you could look at is God told Balaam to wait in the morning, right, for him to get summoned and then rise up and go together with them. But it seems like in this, in what is happening is the next morning he just got up, saddled his donkey, and he went with them on his own volition, and he did not wait for the princes to come and summon him. Right? So there could be one issue that is right there, which is a little bit more looking into the wording and did he literally do exactly what God said. Now, the second reasoning is a little bit different. Just kind of some things that I remember, like life with Sunstream 2, is I remember a lot of different things that have happened where Sunstream says that, hey, sometimes he tells people to do something because that's what they really want. Right, and it's a really sad thing because he said, you know, you got to think about the position that he's in. And let's just say Jesus comes, right? Let's say Jesus comes and says, hey, don't do that, but you actually do it. Then what have you done? You've done this grave sin of disobeying the Messiah, which is a very, very big sin, like the direct thing that the Messiah said, okay? So the Messiah talked directly to you and said, don't do this, but you'll do it, okay? So it becomes a bigger sin now because it's directly from the Messiah, and you not only didn't do what was right, but you directly disobeyed the Messiah. So this is why Sunstream said sometimes he will tell people to do, he'll tell people the answer they want to hear. And what's the reason? Because it's a far less sin. And one of the reasons why Sunstream said he does this is because some people come to ask him already having an answer in mind. Which means that regardless of what Sunstream says, they're going to do what they want. So, you know, think about this. Imagine you're the one trying to save people, and then all of a sudden you know that people are going to do whatever they want. What does that mean? It means that if you tell them to do something that they don't want to do, then they are not only disobeying the word, you know, they're not only disobeying and doing the wrong thing, but they are literally disobeying the Messiah, which is a great sin, right? Which means that it's better off for him to just tell them to go and do what they want because they're going to do it anyways, right? So, and then, you know, since we've talked about before is people complain, but they complain because they'll blame Sunstream because Sunstream told them to go that direction. And then they'll say, well, you told me to do this, but it didn't work. But you have to look at what's going through Sunstream's mind is, well, yeah, they're going to do this no matter what. So I'd rather them just go through that instead of, you know, going through an even greater sin of disobeying the one that God sent, right? Which means that there are times that, you know, that God will allow certain things to happen. And then, you know, eventually will, you know, people pay the consequences for their actions. Right. And because I was thinking about those things, I was thinking, wow, maybe like if you think about it, you knew that Balaam actually his heart was changing because in the past, he's like, I can only say what God wants. Boom. And I'm only going to do this. Right. However, at this point, when they finally came, you know, they offered him more riches. He's like, no, I can't do this anyways. And then he's like, but sleep here a night and let me talk to God again, which means, you know, that his heart is changing. Because if it wasn't changing, he would have just said, no, guys, get out of here. I got to go. But the fact that he says, wait a night, let me talk to God, is showing how much he really, really, really wanted to do that thing, to do something in his own mind, in his own way. And it seems like God is the one saying, all right, well, you know, this is what you're thinking you want to do. And then the next day he gets rebuked, like, maybe, you know, in my mind, I'm like, oh, maybe God is thinking that this guy has a chance. Like, when he wakes up in the morning, he'll change his heart. He'll change his mind, right? And realize that it's the wrong thing to do. But he didn't realize, and he went on with it, right? So for myself, I don't know what the full answer is, but I'm looking at some of the things that I've seen in the past, some of the things that Sunseem has talked about in the messages too. And that's kind of one of the ways that I'm looking at and saying, oh, you know, that's quite possible. It could be like this, right? And it could be like this too. Because it does seem weird that verse 20, God says go. And then verse 22 is like, I'm mad at you for going. And you're like, what? But you told me to go. But I've seen so many times where, well, I've heard many stories too, where people would go no matter what. And then after, you know, they would blame Sunseem, like, well, you told me to go this, but then Sunseem knows that their hearts, like, hey, I knew you'd go anyways, but it's better for you to be mad and angry at this rather than having such a great sin, right, of disobeying the one that God has sent. So this is one of the ideas that I had in my head. So this is not law, as in Sunseem said this and Sunseem said that. No, this is something that I'm kind of deducing together, and it's something that we can think about too. And you know, Sunseem gives us the principles and the ability to reason and think about carefully, oh, I wonder why this is happening in a certain way, right? And of course, eventually, and then we learn the truth, like what is the exact truth, what's exactly being said. I'm just going by certain things that I've seen and experienced that we could say, oh, this is probably possible too. So that is a story from Numbers chapter 22, verses 20 to 22. All right. So that is today's question of the day. Hope that is something that really excited your mind and helped and made you think a little bit more deeply, which leads us into today's song of choice. And I'm going back to Canada. I'm possibly going back to Canada, so I'm going to play a Canadian singer, Justin Bieber. He's got a whole new life ahead of him. He's singing these better songs with better lyrics. This song is called Hold On, and this just came out recently in 2021. Great song. If you hear the lyrics, guys, I know it's very hard to say Justin Bieber and great song, but the last couple ones, like Holy, that song Holy was really good, and this one's really good too. I'll just tell you some of the lyrics here. It's like, says, I need you to hold on. Heaven is a place not too far away. And, you know, we all know I should be the one to say we all make mistakes. So take my hand and hold on. Tell me everything that you need to say, because I know how it feels to be someone. It feels to be someone who loses their way, right? So it seems like a very, it does seem like there's a change in heart with Justin Bieber and the way that he's living. He got married, probably going to have kids pretty soon too. And it looks like he is settling down a bit and getting his roots back to where it should be, back to God. So this is a great song. It's called Hold On by Justin Bieber.
You know you can call me if you need someone. Pick up the pieces if you come undone. Painting stars up on your ceiling, cause you wish that you could find some feeling. Yeah, you know you could call me if you need someone. I need you to hold. A place not too far away. We all know I should be the one to say we all make mistakes. Take my hand and hold on.
Tell me everything that you need to say.
'Cause I know how it feels to be someone.
Oh yeah,
feels to be someone who loses the way.
Till morning, call if you need somebody. I will be there.
And there it is. That is Justin Bieber with Hold On. Tell me, guys, you like that song. That's the song. It's not that bad. The lyrics are actually pretty clean. I like it. Talks about heaven, holding on, even though it's a little bit difficult. He talks about his own sins, that, you know, he's someone who knows how hard it is. And we all made mistakes. So he says, take my hand. It's probably God saying, take my hand and hold on. And tell me everything that you need to say. So I really hope that you guys enjoyed that song. I'm very, very happy that Justin Bieber is moving forward into a new direction of better music with better lyrics. All right, guys. So that means we're getting into the final segment of today. And what is the final segment? Of course, it is Thursday, which means we're going to listen to another segment of Victory Rhymes by Yungsae from South Africa.
Yo, what's up, everyone? Welcome to another segment of Victory Rhymes here on the Morning Star Drive. This is a collection of resurrected poetry written by the awesome people of this history. And presented by me, I am Yungsae. I am from South Africa, but I've been living in Korea for the last 5 years. And this is my 6th year living in Korea, working as an English teacher. But actually, I'm a theater graduate from South Africa, where I also worked as an actress, a theater actress. I really like poetry. I like to read other people's poems. I like to write poems. And I think it really opens the door to a person's heart to really see what they really feel. And very often people can express themselves much better in writing. I'm one of those. So that makes sense why I like poetry. And yeah, so I am here to share the poems written by the awesome people of this history with you guys. And today's poem is a very fun topic. A topic that I like so very, 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 very much. And that I think a lot of you might like very, very, very much as well. I know Pastor Sky definitely does. Pastor Sky really loves this topic as well. And what is it? You guessed it, guys. It's coffee. So if you really like coffee, then you're gonna like this poem today. And even if you don't like coffee, I hope you can also get something out of it. I'm sure you will, because just wait and see. There's something in there for everyone. Okay, so this poem was written in a time when, you know, that time when we didn't drink any coffee. Those of you who were in the history before Sunsim came back, you know what I mean. And that was a time where, yeah, we didn't drink coffee. And so even though I really liked coffee a lot back in South Africa, before I came to Korea and before I came to this history, I did like it very much. And when I came to Korea, I discovered Starbucks for the first time, and I was a venti drinker, y'all. If you know Starbucks, yeah, I was that person who would get the venti, and that was not my only coffee for the day. And then I would still wish that that venti would be bottomless because I really like the taste of coffee and I like the smell of it. And I just like the whole idea of coffee. It's just, yeah, I really like it. You get the point. Okay, so, but even so, even though I was such an avid coffee drinker, I was really thankful, and I am still very thankful, that I didn't drink coffee at that time. And I'll tell you why. You know, that was a time when we prayed at 1 a.m. And I prayed at 1 a.m. every day. And I also worked full time. And I would be very busy meeting people, working and going here and there, and not drinking any coffee made me realize about the power of the spiritual strength that I got through prayer. And I remember looking at my co-teachers at school who would drink so much coffee, like that I, a coffee lover, was just shocked. Like, I couldn't even imagine drinking that much coffee. But they would still not be energetic. They would still complain and be like, kind of just mellow, you know. But I felt so energized. And I remember at that time, I was like, wow, I certainly sleep less than any of them. But I don't drink coffee. And I felt so much more energized than them. So I was like really amazed by that. And during that time, I wrote this poem called Prayer Coffee. So let me take you to the coffee shop of Prayer Coffee and let's listen to this poem. I used to be so tired. Sleep, wake up, snooze, sleep. Wake up, oh, crave more sleep. Calculate lunch break minutes to contemplate nap time. I used to sleep so much and wake up still living my life asleep. Living from caffeine fix to caffeine fix. Until I discovered the coffee of the spirit. A cup that gives you endless jitters of joy, endless power, fire, and focus. I don't sleep as much anymore. I meet him every pre-dawn at the prayer coffee shop. The prayer coffee shop is always open, always free, always fresh, and I can always find my beloved there. I hold onto the gold member card, because leaving this warmth is just too hard. His word is the Starbucks to my soul, pure spiritual coffee that never makes me crash. I'm high on this caffeine of his word, and that's the happiness password. So that is the poem called Prayer Coffee that I wrote in that time that we did not drink coffee. But of course, things are very different now, and we're in a different time, and things are different, and I am back to drinking coffee, and I'm very happy about it because I love coffee. And I'm reminded of a story letter that Sangsnim wrote in 2019. I think it was story letter number 2. Yeah, I'm not exactly sure of the date, but at the end of the story letter, Sangsnim said, "My coffee is getting cold." And I was so happy. I was so happy seeing that. And I was like, wow, he drank coffee. But I'm sure he does not drink coffee every day. And who knows, it might even have been decaf coffee. But nonetheless, I was just so happy he spoke about coffee. And I'm so happy to be drinking coffee at the moment. And I do enjoy it very, very much. But I do enjoy it with the Lord. You know, I really enjoy sharing the thing that I like with the Lord and going on coffee dates with the Lord and with the Trinity. It's very fun for me, and then I have a coffee with the Lord. So maybe you can also try that today when you have your coffee break. Go sit somewhere nice, even if there's just a tree or some kind of place where you can be kind of out of the buzz. And maybe most of you are at home because of COVID, but just find some space that is peaceful and have a coffee with the Lord. It's always fun for me. And I was very happy that we can go back to drinking coffee. But you know what? We have to caffeinate wisely, y'all, because coffee does affect your brain and it affects your sleeping quality for sure. So I do try my best to stick to, I know it's ideal to stick to one a day. I'm not gonna say I achieve that every day because I usually end up drinking two, but I try my best to to do one or like two at most. Yeah, because and also to drink coffee, like I try to not drink coffee in the afternoon, because you know caffeine stays in your blood for quite long and it does affect your sleep quality. And you know, there are many people say, you know what, I'm like one of those people, I'm like been drinking coffee for so long, so even though I drink coffee like 2 hours before bed, I'm still like fine, I could sleep. Or some people drink coffee like in the afternoon, even just like at 2 p.m. or 3 p.m. and they sleep fine. But the actual truth behind this is that even though you can fall asleep, that does not mean you get quality deep sleep, y'all. It does affect your sleep quality, and that's maybe why sometimes we think, oh, but you know, I slept enough, but you still wake up opening our eyes and craving coffee, and we're kind of like zombies, pre-dawn zombies, because we haven't had our first coffee yet. So caffeinate wisely. You are very precious, and I would love for everyone to be wide awake and clear-minded in the pre-dawn. Yeah. We don't want to be, you know, like dependent on coffee. We just want to enjoy it, you know? We want to enjoy it, but we don't want to be like needing it to be awake, because that's not good. That's not healthy. But let's enjoy it together with the Lord. And I hope when you drink your next cup of coffee, whenever, that you can think of the Lord and enjoy it with Him, or say a prayer and remember how much strength and power we get from the Word, and how exhausted we would be if we didn't have the Word, if we didn't pray. We would be so exhausted that not even the strongest coffee in the world could pick us up from that kind of exhaustion. The Word and the prayer is definitely our source of power, and we should always remember that and be thankful. And I hope that every cup of coffee reminds you of that, and that your heart will just be overflowing with thanks, and you can remember all the things of the past, all those times you really prayed and you gained strength, and those times you really listened to the Word and you gained strength. Every Sunday, every day we listen to the Word, we gain strength. And may every cup of coffee remind you of that. Hope you have a great day, everyone. May you resolve all the cons, all the weaknesses, and let them pros and strengths shine. I'll be back next week with another episode of Victory Rhymes. This is Yongsei. Goodbye.
And there you go. What an amazing poem today. Yes, it was something that was really dear to my heart. I could feel the Shimjung so deeply. Yes, I'm so caffeinated by the Word. Yes, it is. All right, awesome. Thank you so much, Yongsei, for another awesome edition of Victory Rhymes. Already 23 weeks in the making. I hope you guys keep praying for her and making sure that she can continue to do this more and more. Guys, remember, submit your poems in there. You have the email in the description. Send in poems, anonymous, whatever it is. Definitely something that I think is a benefit that all of us here participate in this podcast. All right, guys, what does that mean? End of the Thursday podcast. Everyone, have amazing, awesome, awesome, awesome Thursday. And we're going to see you guys tomorrow on the Morning Star Drive on 117.8.
It's the Morning Star Drive, 117.8. You soaring up with sky, now's the time, don't delay. I'm sitting in my ride and it's time to fly. So let's realign, just listen and fill your mind.
I'm burning with desire and the passion. Nobody can stop me when I'm like this. I got my head in the zone, you know. I'm on the Morning Star Drive, you know. I'm burning with desire.